assist with your CAD modeling. All right, so today's special event is going to be in partnership with TransMagic and DCS. My name is Ben Reese. I'm with DCS Marketing, and I'll be your moderator today, helping with questions and supporting Brad, who you can see on the webcam. There's a short survey at the end. Just make sure everyone's seeing what I'm seeing here. Good. There's a short survey at the end. Please let us know your feedback. We also have a special offer for you today. If you'd like to try out some of today's tools, Brad is going to be offering a special trial. If you're listening in, please use your computer speakers or headset. You'll get the best audio that way instead of using a phone call. There'll be a recording of today's session sent out tomorrow, along with some additional content links. Throughout today's session, please send in your questions. I'll be answering them privately, and then we'll be setting aside a few to field during the Q&A session at the end. Later this month, we have the third part of our 7-7 series. I hope all of you will be able to join us for that, especially since we'll be showcasing a new tool for 3DCS, our sequence optimization, that we're very excited about. Invite a manufacturing engineer in your manufacturing department to join you so they can see how you can optimize sequences of clamps and joins using 3DCS. So today's focus will be on the TransMagic tools. Some of those tools are available if you have 3DCS Multi-CAD through our DCS converter, which is powered by TransMagic technology. The DCS converter is available in your geometry tab, all the way on the right, DCS converter, and will open a window that looks like this. And the DCS converter has a number of special tools you can use for a couple of different actions other than just translating parts. There are two different types of TransMagic packages that DCS offers: our TransMagic Base, when you want to use STEP and IGES files, and the TransMagic Power Pack that we recommend, as it allows you to use your direct native CAD files in DCS or 3DCS Multi-CAD. Now, the DCS converter has a number of other tools other than just bringing in CAD files. It can be used for creating specific geometry parts. So if you want to add a block, a cylinder, a sphere, or some kind of dummy part to your model to either represent tooling, or if you're trying to test a different modeling method, you can actually create those using the DCS converter. You can also use the DCS converter to mark up and annotate 2D drawings. You can use it to query your model and measure distances. These are just a few of the different tools that are available in the DCS converter that comes with 3DCS Multi-CAD. If you'd like to learn more, I recommend opening up the help manual or going to our DCS community, and you can find all of the different functions listed there. If you'd like to see some how-to videos, let us know in the survey after today's event that you'd like to see a webinar on the DCS converter. That way I can get some backing to get that done, and we can create some how-to videos. If you would like to see that, please, in the suggestions or questions after today's event in the survey, note any of the specific tools that you might have in mind that you'd like to see showcased. So today's presentation is going to be primarily on TransMagic. So if you do happen to have the license of TransMagic in addition to 3DCS, or if you're interested in trying it out, it is a very inexpensive package that can be shared between your team. Brad Strong, the Technical Communications Manager at TransMagic, is going to be showing us how to use TransMagic to help support a number of different CAD modeling processes. At this time, I'm going to be passing the presentation over to Brad.
Okay, thank you, Ben. Let's see here.
Yeah, you may have to share and then switch screen again.
Oh, can everything look okay?
Everything's perfect.
Okay. Can you guys see my PowerPoint and my TransMagic?
Yes.
Okay. Good deal. So this is the agenda I'm going to cover today. I'm going to start off by talking about how to open, view, and just access any major 3D CAD format. We'll talk about PMI, settings and choosing the right CAD format, which is a really important aspect to what all of we do. And light repair, and we'll get into advanced repair, getting good geometry from spline geometry to analytic geometry and what that really means. We'll talk about querying the model, dimensioning, manipulating assemblies, some polygonal tools, and then comparing models to see which revision, what the revision really changed, and if the CAD part is really close enough to being the original CAD part you got from Boeing or whoever, so that it passes a validation check. So that's my intent today. Most of this stuff is in TransMagic Expert or Pro, and then the last two things are add-ons, Magic Heal and Magic Check, and I'll talk about the details of those when we get to them. So here's just a quick look at the CAD formats that TransMagic can open. And for those of you using DCS, I think you already have access to these. Major CAD formats and neutral CAD formats, including Parasolid, ACES, STEP, and IGES, and then polygonal formats. So I'll go ahead and start and just show you a little bit about the usability of TransMagic. So I'll go to my open button and we'll grab a simple assembly to illustrate how a few things work.
And this assembly you're using is an Inventor assembly, correct?
That's right. These are all sample files. Okay, so here's my assembly. I'm just using a 3D mouse to rotate this around, but if you wanted to use these standard tools, they're on the side here for rotate and zoom and pan. You've also got the same tools up on your view toolbar and on your right mouse button. So, but the 3D mouse, as some of you probably already found out, is a really good way to go. I've got a 3D connection mouse myself. I noticed that some of these parts are a little bit dark, so I could just grab them all and either take my chances with a random colorize or select objects one at a time. And like maybe I want to change these, excuse me, maybe just want to change these using my control key, select a few things and go to change color. And I've got on the left side an assembly browser. So this will show me this stuff in my assembly. I've got parts, which are represented by a single gear, and the full assembly at the top, and the sub-assembly here, which I've just opened up. I'm going to open up another file to illustrate the PMI aspects. So we'll go to our CATIA folder.
And will this look similar to a an X model? Is the FTA from CATIA, is it displayed in similar fashion to the PMI in NX?
An X model. Not familiar with the
NX.
NX, yeah. Yeah, well yeah, I mean this is from CATIA. We can open up an NX example too. It's going to be exactly the same in how it looks. So whatever, if it's a major 3D CAD format, we can open it. And I think that's one of the reasons you guys include it in your kit. So, and you see the PMI looks a little bit different. You know, it's based on how the PMI was put into the part, but if we want to change that, we can go to settings. In fact, we've got settings is one of our strengths, over 200 settings. If I go to PMI, I can override the default PMI settings and change the text color and the line color. I can turn off enable PMI translation if I don't want to deal with it. Let's say it's a giant assembly. Or if I want to write my PMI out to wires, I can do that and save this to any CAD format, including IGES. So there's a few different options. So if we go back to our clamp assembly, let's look at the PMI example first. We were talking about the assembly browser, and you can see in the assembly browser, this is a single part, but does have PMI annotations. So I can click on any of these and zoom in on those. Or I can change my settings, my select settings to PMI, and using this single select tool, click on any PMI note and get it a highlight of the geometry so I can really see what I've got, what I'm dealing with, and where that PMI note goes to. So there's no doubt. And I think that's one of the strengths of PMI is that, you know, it's on the part and it's obvious where it goes rather than looking at a drawing and trying to keep the two, the drawing and the model in sync. While we're looking at this, why don't we look at some other PMI tools? Under operations, I've got a PMI on off button and I've got a PMI view browser. So the PMI view browser lets me click on any PMI view which was created at the time this part was originated, and it'll show me just the PMI for that view. So it's a way you can kind of walk through a very complex model, and you know, this is fairly simple, but some get really hairy. So you can parse it up and manage it better this way. And then when you get to the within each view, you can click on the note for that view and it should hover that. It should zoom in on that particular note. Now I'm going to go ahead and select all four of these views and export them to a file. And I'm going to use a PDF. And we'll save this. So this will be a 3D PDF. And while we're waiting for that to translate, you can see up here we have captures. So this PMI view browser will also allow you to see sectional views of, let's say, holes or whatever you need a section of. So the benefit of that is we were just working with a major auto manufacturer who they had like 100 sectional views of holes in this machine that's used for drilling holes in engine blocks. And they were getting out of sync all the time. And so having it in PMI helps them to keep it all in sync and all in one place and not have these giant drawings that take up entire walls of their space. So let's go ahead and open the file that was just created. So I'm sure a lot of you are dealing with 3D PDF already, but for those who haven't, this is what they look like. And if I just press and drag on the inside of this screen area, I can get access to all those views. It's a real model. It is a polygonal model, but it definitely conveys the geometry we need to see and the notes. And over here we have our model tree, and we have access to all those PMI views that came in with the part. And we can zoom those. And we've got our model tree on the left here, as well as our 3D PMI, which came in that model tree from the original part. If we look at our clamp assembly, on this, I might want to add some material to this, apply some materials to it. So I'm going to go to my assembly browser and just pin that open. And this is my cylinder base, and you'll see that the assembly browser selects and zooms whatever you click on. So what I want to do here is select the base of the part and go to my material and right click it and set it to a different material. So let's pick aluminum 6061. And then we'll select it and go to mass properties. And you can see what it is in cubic inches and pounds. We can get our center of mass. And that's defined by these intersection of these three planes. And we can get our moments down below and select this to delete it. We can also get our surface area for this part. And this is in square inches, but if we want to change that, it's easy to do. Hopefully one of the things you're seeing here is ease of use. So if I go to general and application units, I can change that to centimeters or whatever I want. And if I want to put this out to a tech document, I can do that with tech doc settings. And I can fill in my title page, my part information. I can check all these boxes because I want all that information. I can set up attachments, and I've got one preset here, but you just add files and add any CAD file you want to this list. And then you can filter by the parts you want to see within the list. And I'll go ahead and hit OK on that. And then we'll go ahead and publish this tech doc. This will be another 3D PDF. Now this is going to write out all of these different parts as a 3D rotatable image to the 3D PDF. And again, you can attach a CATIA file or whatever it is you want to attach to that part. So let's go take a look at that. Okay, so here's the tech doc. And we have to go ahead and trust this document. And I'm getting a little bit chunky response from probably the video and the WebEx slowing me down a little bit. So here you can see we can rotate that around. We can zoom it in. And the file information that came with the file. This particular part has no user-defined attributes, but if it was there, it would pop into this slot. Your surface area, volume, material name, mass, density, all that, center mass. And then we've got all of our parts. And let's see if we can find the part we applied a material to. There we go. Okay, and here's our aluminum 6061 on the cylinder base. Over on the left, we still have access to the part or the assembly tree. Oh, actually, we have the cylinder base up right now, so we're not going to see the full assembly tree. So let's go to the top. And now we can see the whole assembly tree. And if we go to our attachments, we should see the step file I attached, but I'm not seeing it. So if we have time, I'd be happy to do that one again, but we'll move on. And these are the pages. So the benefit of this is you can send somebody a document, a 3D PDF that has everything in it, including an attached file or attached files. So it's better than a zip file where everything is kind of mixed up. Okay, so also want to talk about light repair. So this is built into all core TransMagic products. Open up a sample file. Let's go to IGES. IGES is always good for repairs, because they're mostly surfaces and they need to be stitched together at minimum. Now, normally when you use TransMagic, it's gonna try to repair this right away. But I personally turn that off because I don't want repairs to happen before I open the file, because it can slow down the file. If it was a 100 megabyte file and you just wanna view it, why would you wanna repair it? So I've turned that setting off, but if I want to repair it now, I just click this button, Auto Repair Wizard. And so it finds 83 surfaces and it suggests we run light repair. Okay, so we get the green light, which means it's a watertight solid. In fact, this is a single part with two bodies, right? Two solid bodies. First thing I want to do is go to this body and change the color of it so we can see it better. It's too dark. And as we look at this, it's got two cylinder halves instead of one. It's a like split periodic. And we have a lot of these splits in here because this is just a spline model that was solidified. So what I can do is, first of all, let's query it to see what this is really composed of. And I can see this is composed of all splines. All the faces are splines, all the edges are splines. That's the lowest common denominator in a CAD model. And so what we want is, if we can get them, is analytic surfaces. We want our analytic geometry, cylinders, planes, etc. So let's grab everything and run light repair again. And okay. Now you can see some of those splits are gone. So let's look at the query again. And you can see that we only have three splines in the faces and 47 in the edges. And some splines make sense. Sometimes you can't define it with analytic geometry. Otherwise, everything would look really prismatic in the CAD world, but it doesn't. So we've got nine cylinders, 22 planes, circles, arcs, lines. So that's better geometry for downstream purposes, because when you're doing NC programming, it's going to want to see a cylinder, not a spline. So we've got better geometry now. And the other thing that comes up sometimes is you've got a part and you want an assembly. So it's easy to go from a part to an assembly with TransMagic. You just right click and do a change, convert to assembly. So there's our assembly, and there's our two solid bodies. And we can rename this to saddle. And there it is. Okay, so that's some real basic repair. There's another repair I want to show you, which is something we sometimes run into. I've had a chance to use it a few times. Under repair, I can turn on filter by color. So if I do that and I open up a file that's really a mess, but the colors are right, I can make use of it. So I'll show you what I mean by that. Under this file, this is an IGES file. It's a four bar assembly where the colors are right, but it's composed entirely of surfaces. And the real problem with this model is that these surfaces are coplanar. This side of the green bar is on the same plane as this side of the blue bar. And that can throw a wrench into any repair software. So by using the repair by color option that I just checked the box for, I can now, first of all, just show you that this is all surfaces, which most of us hate surfaces. So I'll go to Auto Repair Wizard. And we're just going to run light repair. That's all that that really does. And it's telling us there's 96 entities or surfaces. And now we've got a solid, four solid bodies in one part, and they're all nice and tidy. We could turn that into an assembly too if we wanted to. So you have a lot of flexibility in how you deal with data that came in from who knows where. Okay, so those are, that kind of covers light repair. I do want to talk about formats and settings. So to do that, I'm going to go back to the PowerPoint for a minute. So that brings us to this slide. If you check this diagram out, at the top we've got native CAD formats, at the bottom we've got IGES. IGES is the worst because it's, you know, they stopped development in 1996. A lot of people are still using it, but it's almost always composed of surfaces. There's no metadata. There's no real intelligence. You can't get mass or volume. STEP is better. They're still developing STEP, but STEP is not that good. And one of the things we like to try to convey is that if you can, don't use IGES and don't use STEP. Sometimes STEP's your only option, but when you can, go with the native CAD format. And if you can't get the native CAD format, or if you can't give the native format, then use the solid modeling kernel. So the solid modeling kernel is the geometric engine through which the native CAD format is built. So a CATIA cat part file, its kernel is CGM, the CGM solid modeling kernel. So, and if it's NX, the foundation of NX is Parasol, the Parasol kernel. So if you're going to send something to somebody who has NX and you can't give them the native file, give them the Parasol kernel, or you could actually do JT also. Both those would be the same. If it's SolidWorks and you can't give them a native SolidWorks file, give them the Parasol kernel, because that's just as good geometrically. It's absolutely as good as the native. What you might miss is some of the metadata. And if we jump over to settings again for a minute. Okay, so if we go to formats and let's say we're gonna read a CATIA V5 file. Publication data, you might not get that in the CGM modeler. I haven't actually tested that. Some other aspects, if you're writing a JT file, you might want to write it using a JT config file. You might want to turn on or off the BREP data checkbox so that you're giving, you know, because JT has BREP CAD data and VisRep polygonal data all in one by default. So do you really want both of those? Maybe it's just for visualization purposes. So this is where those 200 checkboxes come in to get your data as good as you can get it. What version are you writing to? How are you reading and how are you writing? And just to continue this discussion here on this CAD format ladder, if you got something in from a customer who's using CATIA and you get the native CAD format, great. And then somewhere along the way, you convert it to STEP. And then you're gonna send it to someone else who needs it in NX or something as close as possible. Well, you've already turned it into a STEP file. So you've already gone down low on this CAD format ladder. So you've already lost some value, some CAD data, some precision. So what you wanna do is avoid going down to STEP and IGES when possible. And if you have to choose between STEP and IGES, choose STEP. Okay, so also when I talked about light repair, I just want to point out that what we're doing is stitching surfaces, converting splines to analytic geometry. When I did that, I ran light repair twice. That's an important distinction. The first pass is just to stitch. The second pass is to improve the CAD data. And then also what we're doing there is finding and correcting zero length edges, duplicate vertices, and edges. Now we've covered most of the model query. I've got one or two more things to show on that. So if we select this body, we can go to operations and get a bounding box. And so that's just for that part. And we're getting our X, Y, and Z values for that geometry. I think I'm set to a very precise bounding box. That's in settings under performance. If I want a bounding box for this whole thing, so we have to ship this. I can get that. We'll delete that. We can dimension this. So if I want to dimension just this edge, I can press and drag. Here's another edge. I want the distance from the front of the part to the back of the part. If I want the distance from front of this to the back of this, just another example of that. Maybe this radius. So you're just clicking on edges or faces. And if you want a single edge or face, that's just press or click, release, click. And I want this diameter or the distance between these two holes. And if it's center to tangent, maybe this angle. So it gives you an idea of what you can do with dimensioning. There's also annotation. So I might want an annotation on an edge.
Hey, Brett.
Or some text. Yes.
While you're adding these annotations and such, these adjustments, where are they saved? Are they saved directly into the native CAD file that you brought in?
No, they're saved into this document, into what we call a TMR file, TransMagic's version of ACES. We can also do text markup. Now, the text markup is temporary, so I'll just put that note in and we can add a free markup to that. And shapes, and as soon as I rotate, that's gone. So we would copy that. If we wanted to save that, we would go to view and copy image and paste that. The other thing I think I left out was calculating edges. So by default, we're in dynamic selection mode, which means if you click once on something, you get a face, twice you get the body, and three times you get the assembly. So you can also select edges, and maybe I need to break these edges, so I need to know how much it's going to take in time based on length. So I'll right click that and query total edge length, and let's see what else I got here. Extracting data from this an assembly or a part. You can do that with save as, and we haven't used save as yet, but if you want to save to any given format, use save as. In this case, we'll go ahead and save it as step, and I'll go ahead and make a folder for this because it's going to atomize, and we'll say it goes in this folder. And what I'm going to do is I've got assembly as XML checked. I don't have any PMI in here, so I can't use that, but I can grab mass property, surface area, and bounding box data and click save. And so what it's going to do is save out. Okay, I'm not sure what that is, but we'll look at the file. So it's writing out all those components as separate step files. So if you're doing 3D printing, you could write them all out as separate STL files and parse this thing down into usable parts. So here's all those parts, and each one's, well, we got Let's find our XML document. Here it is. So I'm going to take this XML document from the cylinder clamp and edit with Notepad++. And so we have our bounding boxes and our transforms and materials. All that stuff is in this document. And we can do that with PMI and surface area, et cetera. It's all in there. And so we have all these stepped files created automatically for us. Okay, so that's pretty much what I wanted to show with just basic TransMagic, even though there's a lot more we could go into. The other things I want to show was just real quickly the advanced repair, which is Magic Heal, and Magic Check, which is the comparison. So let's look at, I left out polygonal tools. Let's do that real quick. So I'm going to go to polygonal example. See what I've got here. Here we go. This is a good one. So 3D printing or additive manufacturing is becoming a bigger thing these days, especially with our manufacturing, offshore manufacturing getting interrupted, and it's a way to create more parts locally, quickly, rather than wait for them to be delivered. So this is a step file. I noticed that it's got some of those split periodics on it. So it's got, you know, it's not the best geometry we could have. In fact, why don't we just query this real quick? Okay, so what I'm seeing is a lot of splines, but yeah, we have some cylinders too. So let's see if we can improve this. We'll go ahead and select it and light repair, and we'll see this edge go away. And let's run this in the polygon reduction tool. So the polygon reduction tool gives us a way to reduce polygons visually and intuitively rather than by just numbers. We can do that too, but it's nice to have a visual option. So you can see it's already kind of taken its best guess. And this is 100% of a value we can still edit. So there are some defaults for the precision of this part, and it's reading those defaults to come up with this fastening. So starting at that point, I want, let's say, 40% of that, and we'll see these get a little rougher. Geometry is getting a little bit rougher as we go. And what's, you know, what's the precision you need for this part? That's the question. But we can go much denser with this. In fact, we can have our starting point be so dense in terms of faceting that things black with polygons. So that is adjustable. And if we hit OK, it will turn this BREP model into a polygonal model. And now that that's a polygonal model, we can go to our viewing and adjust how that appears, whether we want it as a wireframe or a faceted model or what have you. The other way we can do our polygonal output is through STL write or just polygonal output, because sometimes you're writing other stuff than STL. And what's your normal deviation, maximum surface deviation, and edge percentage, and whether you want it for FEA or for 3D printing. Okay, so into some more complex repair scenarios. Let's open up another model that's got more serious problems. And let's see here, we'll take this one. I just did a webinar yesterday with the Air Force, and several people on there were saying, you know, model quality is a really big thing for us. And so diagnostics to see what's wrong with the model is really important. And that's what this tool gives you. So Magic Heal gives you the ability to run repair. And it shows that this does get a yellow light. It's not just surface that are the problem. It's the fact that there's geometry issues, more deep-seated problems in this file. So it tells us there's two parts. The lower two components have issues. And I'm going to perform recommended actions, which is to run light repair. And light repair is just a first step. And now we see that it wants us to run full repair, which is part of Magic Heal. So I'll run that. And there's our green light, watertight solid model. Now, I want to show you the diagnostics to this. So I'm going to have to open that again. And in the background, my wife is teaching a Montessori class, music class. So if you hear some noise, sorry about that. Everybody's working from home on Zoom and whatever these days. I'll try to focus. So the thing I'm going to do on this case, rather than just go ahead and repair the model, I'm going to start the repair and then I'm going to exit. And it's going to show me where the problems were. So I'm going to exit. So what we're seeing here is geometry issues highlighted in orange, and then adjacent areas are white. So you can know what's affected by those problems with inverted vertices or whatever the problem is. So diagnostics are built into Magic Heal. The other example I wanted to give you for Magic Heal is a repairing faces that are missing. So if I go to this plastic enclosure, this part's missing faces. And this is not that unusual, especially for organic models. We've had lots of customers come to us with, oh, you know, I use this CATIA translator. I lost all these faces. The first thing you should check is the quality of your CATIA translator, you know, or whatever the format is. Try to retranslate with a better translator, even like using ours as an eval, to see if you can get better data rather than having to repair it. So that's why I wanted to focus on formats first, using the native format, good quality translators. But if you're using the best translators you can get your hands on and you still lost data, that's the situation we're looking at here. So how do you repair it? So I'm going to go to the auto repair wizard. And the first thing it's going to do is run light repair as usual. And I'm going to accept that. And what it's doing here is showing us there's a lot of open circuits or missing geometry. So it says you can cover these holes with Magic Heal tools. It's semi-automatic. So here's what I have to deal with. So I've got Magic Heal toolbar right here. And the first thing I'm going to do is get the probably the trickiest one, which is this arrow boss. It's missing its sidewalls. So I'm going to select the two edges, the one at the top and the one at the bottom, and skim between edges. And so that's done. And now I'm going to click Find Next. And it's going to find all the openings that have issues. So this opening needs a little bit of discussion because you can see there's more than one face missing here. We lost some chunks of data here, some faces. So there's no magic we can do to get that back. And you know, you just can't magically create whatever that transition was. So what we're going to do is move ahead by grabbing an edge and saying, set it to smooth. Set this so that it's smooth to all adjacent areas. And then we're going to cover selection. So it's going to do the best it can for that geometry. And let's go to Find Next again and grab an edge. And we're going to set this one smooth also. So we can just walk through the part with this semiotic kind of mode. This one we also want smooth. And next, and edge, and smooth, and cover. And if you have these already, the attributes already set to smooth, you can just run the machine gun surface and it'll cover them all. You can go have a cup of coffee if it's a really big file. You see this looks a little faceted. That's just the CAD system trying to go, or Transmagic trying to go fast. We can increase that resolution easily. I'm going to set that to smooth and continue. And next. So here it's a, these are all sharp. So I'll grab this and set sharp and cover and next and sharp and cover and next. And this one's a combo. So for a combo, I'll say I want this edge and this edge, and I'll hold down my control key to be set smooth to the adjacent surfaces, and then this edge and this edge. And I'm holding down control key, and I think I missed that. Let's see if I can get a better angle on that thing. Okay, this edge and this edge to be set to sharp, and I'm holding down my control key. And now we have two different colors or two different sets of attributes on that circuit, that open circuit. And so I am into dynamic selection, so we'll grab this and cover selection and find next, and that's it. We've covered all those openings in just a couple of minutes. And now it's time to select all and stitch it all together, because those purple surfaces are new. And the reason we've got that deep purple is to make it clear that those are new surfaces, especially in the case of this one in the upper right. You need to know, and you know, the team needs to know that that's a replaced surface. These others should be pretty rock solid, but that one, we assumed a few things because we were missing so much geometry. And this is a watertight solid now. And if you want to, you can go in and just double check with mass properties and make sure you can get a volume on that and a mass on that so you know it's legit. And then if we wanted to, we could also change the color. So now it's all ready for the customer. Okay, so that's Magic Heal. A real quick look at that. And so we are now, we've done this. This covers some of those things. How are we doing on time, Ben?
We're doing pretty good. We have 10 minutes left. What do you have left to go through?
I think I can squeeze in one quick comparison and then we'll have time for questions.
Great.
Okay. So comparison, I'm going to go ahead and just close this and shuttle those things real fast so that we, because comparison's a little bit differently how we do it. And I'm going to open two files at once to do the comparison. And we'll be showing a revision analysis, but the same steps apply to a validation analysis. It's the same basic process. So I'm going to go to Magic Check, and I'm going to open up. Actually, I think I'll do the validation analysis, and you'll get. You know, they both have pros and cons. Why don't we do the revision analysis, because it's a really small part and it'll go fast. So grab these two parts and make sure they're in order. The original is at the top. So far we've just opened two files. It's going to lay those two files on top of each other. Since it is a revision, it should have the same geometry, same origin points and all that. If it doesn't, you can move the parts overlapping each other with the three-point move. So right now it's going to look like we have one part. But on, we've got source and target down below and a node for each. And these are the names of those parts. And if I click on the target node, you can see it's got no slot in it. And the source node does. So that's one of the big difference. And let's say that's the difference the customer told us about. Hey, we got rid of the slot. And so we're supposed to mold this or whatever our task is. So I've got this on revision analysis as opposed to validation analysis. I'm going to go to Magic Check settings and notice that it's I've got to 5/1000ths of an inch tolerance. So if there's anything outside of that, anything that is not within that tolerance, I want to know about it. And I also want to know properties checked to 1%, and I want really good picture of where the problems are. So I'll drag this slider up. It takes a little bit longer that way, and I'll click OK. And now I can basically just hit Analyze Parts. So that's all I had to do to set this up. Okay, so we got our color map here, and you can see, for example, the blue here, that means that this slot is not existing in the second model, so this is outside of that model's geometry, outside the original part envelope. On this one, you can see the slot, the source slot is on the right, the target slot is on the left. So what's happening is the target slot is cutting into the geometry of the source slot, so that gets a red color plot. And here there's a bevel that they missed, they forgot to tell us. On the target, they added the bevel, but on the source, it's not there. So it gives us a red cue to say, hey, they've done something that is cutting into your original part envelope. And so there's a lot of stuff here. There's several issues. And the one that I really want to take note of is this one right here. So I'm going to save a view of that. So in fact, on Magic Check, we can save a view. And let's just click on View Browser and New View, and I want a view of this as well, and New, and we're good there. Well, we can recreate those views by just clicking on them. That's another aspect to being able to maneuver around in a CAD file, and we'll just close that for now. And now I want to generate a report. Oh, actually, before I do that, some people prefer to have a split view, so you can do that with split window view. And we'll go back to a single window view. And we can find our changes too. Now this kind of powers through them all. Okay, so now let's make our report. And we can put on our user info, but I'm going to skip that and create report. And we'll put this in this demo folder and save. And it is going to be a 3D PDF. And when we get that done, we'll be done. Just want to talk about validation a little bit. We talked about an example with Boeing earlier. So Boeing will send you a CAD part or a CAD product, and you're going to do whatever you do for it. And they'll want to know, did you ever change the format? Let's see the format that you used and the format we gave you, and show us with a validation analysis that they're within 5/1000ths of an inch or whatever their value is for tolerance. And they're going to need that because they don't want it to have changed significantly, because it could pose a safety hazard. So now we're going to double click this part we just made, this 3D PDF. And here's the document, and you can change all this stuff. You've got your source and part numbers. We didn't put in a number. Source and target. The topology check. Sometimes this matters and sometimes it doesn't. In this case, it definitely matters because we changed a lot. But if it's a different format, if you're doing like a validation analysis, they started with a CAD part and you converted it to a step, sometimes those topologies are different anyway. So this is definitely, there's more to the picture than just that. And this is my viewable, rotatable model of the part with the color plot and the different views. And there's that one that we saved. So I wanted to focus on that, or maybe send that to somebody. And that's how that works. And that's it. That covers Magic Check. And then I did want to mention, I talked to the CEO and he says, anybody who's interested, You can do a 30-day eval. Normally our eval is just using the view, super view, but he's offering expert, which is the one that's fully loaded, plus magic heal and magic check. And if you decide to purchase within 30 days, he's giving 20% off.
Right, so that's...
And there's some contact info if you want to follow up on that.
I'll include that in the follow-up email. So there's some questions about how do you access this. So like we said, some of these tools, like for example, the light repair is available in the DCS converter. That is part of your 3DCS multi-CAD. Many of these advanced features, however, are only available in the TransMagic package, which is a separate license, but I believe can be shared between your team. There's a floating license. Is that right, Brad?
You know, I was trying to read one of those questions. Say that last part again.
A floating license. Is this something that can be put on a server?
Yes. Yes, they can do floating licenses for sure. You can have a 110 or a 210. So 10 people could use it, but only two at a time.
Right. So that would be a really good way to gain access to this for your team. It's also a very inexpensive software. It's about the same cost as getting a 3DCS add-on module. And we like to consider it as such because it's a good addition to your total solution set, especially if your customers provide you different CAD files or if you've got multiple clients all using different CAD packages. So it's a great tool to have on hand. We have a couple quick questions here that you know, we weren't able to answer that are going to be good for the team. Here's one that I'm particularly interested in. In regards to repair, when you're repairing issues, can you put the repaired CAD file, can you save that to the CAD file and then bring the repaired file up in your CAD software?
What's the scenario? Yeah. Let's say you're working with, what do you guys use, Ben? Give me an example.
So say I was given a CATIA file, all right?
Okay.
And I needed to repair some surfaces because the file is damaged. Would
yeah.
I be able to repair those surfaces in TransMagic and then reopen it up in CATIA?
Yeah, you can save it as a CATIA file, right? However, when we save it as a CATIA file, you're not going to have the features, and I don't use CATIA, but if we use maybe SOLIDWORKS as an example, SOLIDWORKS, you've got a feature tree, and once we convert that, once we have it open in TransMagic, we've lost features. So we don't have that ability. However, with SOLIDWORKS and Inventor, there's an internal version that runs where you can do the repairs inside. Didn't you just say that you guys do the repair also, Ben?
And
you've got the repair option for light repair.
Yeah, 3DCS Multi-CAD and the DCS converter have light repair.
Yeah, so in that case, if they had that with their CATIA, they could run the repair inside of CATIA and never have to leave. But once you leave CATIA and open it in TransMagic, all of your features are gone.
Okay.
It's just the best solid model we can give you without the feature intelligence.
So here's another good question. So if I have an IGES or a STEP file, would it be good to do the light repair first before trying to use it for anything? Is this something that would be useful for trying to increase those files' usability?
Yeah, definitely. With both of those, I would say run repair. And then just be more conscious about what you ask for or blindly or just defaultly receive from other people or send, because you're losing CAD precision. You know, model precision when you go to STEP or IGES. But definitely STEP's better than IGES, and there are some STEP translators are better than others. So I can tell you, like, Creo has a really good STEP translator.
All right, we're at the top of the hour. I have one more question I'd like to get to. Oh, two more questions. The first one is, on units, is when you bring a CAD file into TransMagic, is there a setting in TransMagic that auto converts it to the units you want, or is it come in as the units set in the CAD file?
It comes in the units set in the CAD file, but I may have to test that. I haven't looked at that for a long time. So if that person wants me to, or if you want me to pass along to you, Ben, I'll like to verify that.
Sure, because I know the DCS converter has a method of converting units in a file, but I'm not particularly clear on the exact process for that. So, all right, let's take a look at that and follow up. Here's another question. If you convert various CAD formats into STEP, can you convert CGR files into STEP files? Can you make CGR into math data?
Yeah, CGR, they're polygonal files, right? They're CATIA polygonal format. So we can go with Expert, we can go from polygonal to, including CGR, to BREP solid model, but there's a cost because, you know, a CAD model is not faceted and a polygonal model is. So every facet on that CGR file becomes a face in the CAD model. So if you do something complex maybe this mobile phone, you know, depending on how many polygons you have on this, if you converted this to a polygonal model, depending on how tightly it was faceted, you'd be fine with this. But a big assembly, forget about it. You don't want to convert a big assembly using the polygonal to CAD converter, or it's going to be too massive. You're going to end up with a gigabyte assembly.
Well, many of our users, I don't think, are afraid of 1 gigabyte assemblies. We've actually had to update a number of our machines internally to 32 gigs of RAM just to open some of these assemblies because they're more than 15 gigabytes.
Well, I did a study on this. So if you go to transmagic.com and look at the blog list, which is right under blog, there's a blog list. I show an example of a part which I converted from polygonal to CAD, and it exploded in size, but it is doable.
Speaking of that, I had another question. This is sort of answering it, I think. So you're talking about the polygons and the tessellation on the part, right?
Yeah.
Is there a way to increase the tessellation on one particular area of the part to get a more detailed surface?
No. Yeah, we don't do that.
Okay.
We do have a different ways of refining it, as I showed with the STL output settings. But we don't locally increase tessellation. One of the things I did not show also is we can bump tessellation up much higher than we saw by default. So again, we can have stuff that's so tessellated it's black.
So you can increase tessellation across the whole part, just not particularly?
Yes, but not locally, right.
Okay. All right, because I know in 3DCS you can increase the mesh in a local area by adding feature points. But that's the meshing over the particular surface. Okay, great. I think that's all right. So we're 4 minutes past the hour, so we're running out of time here. Please take a moment to fill out the survey as you leave the webinar, because there is a place in there for additional questions that we can follow up with you, and I can also pass on to TransMagic and Brad to answer particularly. In addition, we'd like to see if you've got interest in seeing a DCS converter webinar, if that might be something of use to you for us to set into our 2020 series. But I want to thank everyone for spending the time with us today. I hope you're all staying safe in this crazy time we're all living in right now. And I want to thank Brad for joining us for our event. We really appreciate your time today.
Thank you. Thank you guys for attending. And thank you, Ben, for putting it on.
Yeah, this has been a great event. Thank you. I was about to ask you if you could bring that slide up. Now, in the survey, I also added a question where you can opt into that 30-day trial. So if you fill out the survey, if you opt in right there, I'll reach out to you directly and get you started on it this afternoon and connect you with the right people at TransMagic. You can also contact them directly using the information on your screen right now. And we'd be happy to support you through that process. So thank you again for joining us. At this time, I'm going to be closing down the webinar, and you'll be receiving the recording and some additional links tomorrow. And of course, you can reply to that email if you have any questions or would like to see any additional information. And I'd be happy to help you. Thanks again. Thank you, Brad.
Thank you, Ben.